This is DJ Hazy Hay, and you've just tuned in to WALT.
Bringing you the most alternative content since the turn of the millennium. Welcome to Distortion 415. We've got some groovy tunes for you today, folks. First up is a group of boys from New York that'll be sure to win your heart over with their bluegrass and folk sounds. Here are the Punch Brothers.
We got together over the course of 23 years. We'd always talked about doing something together, but we couldn't figure out what that would be. And I think it was when I met this fellow over here. We played some music at the Telluride Bluegrass Festival, and I called Gabe pretty soon after that going, hey, I think I found another person to be in our band.
Last record, Anti-Phogmatic, was very collaborative. You know, somebody will throw out an idea, and if it's a decent idea, other people will have ideas to add on to it, or you know, if you do that, I'll do this, and then hopefully it stimulates everyone.
I think at best, the collaborative writing process is all about collectively deciding what you want to hear that you're not hearing, and that starts to create this like certain longings for something that's not there. It's almost like musical hallucinations or something.
Had my last day drinks in here for free. Cause that's my friend's ending goal. Yeah, I got a friend who intends for me too.
We had finished recording this last album, which became Anti-Phogmatic, and we were searching out a title for it. There are several drinking references on the album, and so much of our time without instruments in our hands is with drinks in our hands instead. And my brother actually came up with this term, anti-phogmatic. Thank you for the, I refer you to Exhibit A. Tell them what an anti-phogmatic is.
An anti-phogmatic is a, sadly, antiquated term for a bracing beverage, typically rum or whiskey that you would have before going out to work in rough weather to stave off any potential ill effects.
We make our living traveling in between places, but it seemed to just be the perfect thing. That's right.
Yeah, we're not the ones who drive.
It's a liability thing.
Baby's at the Posh Bowl with a glass for you to fill. If you'll let it with her in the time she has to kill. Kill, kill, kill. We keep babies in the Posh Bowl. I want you to help yourself.
Hopefully our music in this album could serve a similar purpose that an anti-phlegmatic would serve to someone waking up and getting ready to face their day.
Check 1, 2.
Cool, dude. Not cool.
Welcome back, music lovers. We're going to be taking some requests, so hit up your favorite DJ to hear your favorite song.
Well, looks like we've got our first caller now.
What's up, caller one? You're on the air with WALT. What can we play for you today?
Hey, you guys. She really answered. Oh, DJ Hazy, hey, I love your show. Me and my family and my friends, we listen to it every day when we barbecue with our dogs. We love it. We like to listen to it on their birthdays. We was just wondering if you could maybe play a song for us today, something we all can enjoy.
Well, girl, I think we've got just the thing for you. Up next is one of my personal favorites, a band from Nashville that's been rocking for more than 5,000 years. Here come the Mummies.
This is the story of a nomadic tribe wandering its way across the deserts of the Sahara, with the power to drop tunics with one blow of their horn section. They worked their way up from pleasuring peasants to the high priests and naughty nobility, until one night in 1500 BC, when the music got a little too funky.
With a hungry look in his eye, puts his rice hopper off into the sky. Jumping bones across, gaping holes.
On this installment of Below the Sound, here come the Mummies. They've been described as one of the longest-running comebacks in history.
They've been painted as sort of demons, you know, for what they must have done to the Pharaoh's daughters. But really, Pharaoh's daughters kind of got around. And this one particular evening turned into live sex acts. The Mummies were wrapped up in the moment. They, you know, they thought these girls want to do that. I mean, what's the worst that could happen? We're having fun. We're partying. Well, now they're cursed forever.
About, I don't know, 3,500 years ago, we was just nomadic music people going around the deserts playing for the ladies. Well, we played with the wrong ladies, you know what I mean?
But unlike their fate, their music has never stopped changing.
So as time progressed, the dance music of the ages progresses. So about, I don't know, 30 years ago, we started playing funk. So far, that seems to be working.
The Mummies are responsible for almost all great things that have come from music in the past century. Taught Elvis how to shake his hips. Taught Keith Richards how to hump a guitar. They taught Pete Townsend how to do the windmill.
Ain't no way you can shortcut it. It's all practice, baby. So it don't matter what you're gonna do. You wanna be good, you gotta do it a lot. We've been doing this for 3,800 years.
As the years passed and flings came and went, so too did Uzi's ability to control the funk.
Uzi, or Boozy Uzi, as you know, some have taken to call him.
Uzi, he's the man. Again, they all like to have fun, but he really likes to have fun.
Well, he ruined a lot of shows there for a lot of time. I mean, you know, he was just a blackout drunk. He was drunk before he got on stage. He would keep drinking on stage despite just sloppy playing and lewd gestures. He took off the instruments and guitars at one point and just started humping a speaker.
With Uzi's sobriety unraveling quickly, Spaz became tightly wound.
He's particular about some things. It's beer, it's some Red Bulls, some water, pick out green M&Ms. Hey, he just likes his way. Let's just keep it at that.
Just when things couldn't get any worse, Java caught the flu in bed with his lady. With things starting to oxidize quickly, the toxic tension stench was hard to ignore. The band moved on from funk fanatics to media monsters, falling into the stereotype they had skirted for so long. But at a surprise gathering at Tony Danza's birthday party, the band that once was once again.
Tony Danza's birthday parties were the Woodstock of 1980 sitcom stars' birthday parties. Epic. When Tony Danza got them all together, he brought them all back there and he said, all right, just cut the crap, all right, guys? Just do what you're amazing at. Give the funk to the world. Stop being and start being Mummies again.
With the band back together, they continued to rock the riffs and funk the fans. For Rock and Roll History, I'm David Sharp. This has been Below the Sounds. Yeah.
exercise.
My name is Chris, and I play in the band Less Than Jake.
I'm Buddy. I play the trombone in the same band.
Yeah.
We all kind of met in Gainesville. We were all going to school there. Originally, Chris and our drummer Vinny met in high school in Port Charlotte,
Florida.
And they technically started the band there because that's where the name of the band actually comes from too. They were practicing in Vinny's house and they had a dog named Jake. And that dog got treated like a king. Everything, like they would go get steak for the dog and Vinny would be eating macaroni and cheese. But they were practicing in the back room one time and the dog was getting upset, so they had to stop practicing. And so that's where they got the name for the band, Less Than Jake. So you think of how low could it been? Your time is all you got, it keeps going through your head. Be scared of a lie, I'll make it bad. But hang on, figure when you should have said, whoa. It's for the better, you better ask God. It's okay. What? You didn't need her anyway. I don't want to hear you say no, but even take a place. Whoa, oh, 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 oh. What more can I say? You don't need her anyway. Whoa, oh, 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 oh.
It's been the same four, and then JR came 11 years ago, and then we've had...
a multitude of different horn players.
We had probably three or four other horn players that have been in the mid to late 90s that are no longer in the
band. Yeah, everyone had about a 2 or 3 year limit, and then they moved on to other things. I'm the only horn player that has stuck around the entire time. They couldn't get rid of me.
I don't think any of us really thought that far ahead to if we'd be playing shows 15, 16, 17 years later. I know I didn't.
I think that's what's great about our band too, though, is that we've had such a steady progression as we went along that every time we got to a new level, it was always like this big triumphant thing because none of us had high expectations from the start. So like when we first had our stuff on a 7-inch, we were all like, oh my God, we've made it. And the first time we played at the Hardback to 200 people, we were like, oh my God, we've made it. And the first time we did a tour, we were like, oh my God, we made it. So it's like every time something happened, it just has progressively gotten a little bigger, and we never were like, we gotta look 16 years in advance. We always look about 3 or 4 months in advance and try and work from there, you know? When we first started out, Punk and Skok had like sort of a heyday there when the Boston's got really big and Real Big Fish had their hit single and stuff. And we never really got huge off of that, but it kind of gave us a little bit of a ground base, and that was at the beginning of our career, and so that kind of boosted us up to a certain level, and then we just managed to ride that out through all the other trends and stuff, and we never died out
We got on good early tours too. You know, we were on like the second year the Warped Tour ever went out, so you know, we jumped on things that ended up being successful early, which you know ended up helping the band a lot too. Been so many nights, sleepless bed.
Nice. Glad to see you got all your friends for another night. What? Of- Yeah! Who likes to talk politics?
For safety. They used to always ask, you know, do you have any advice for up-and-coming bands? And I used to have all the stuff that I would say, and, you know, I gotta get in the van and tour, and I was like, just quit. There's too many of us.
Yeah.
Too much competition, we don't need any more.
Yeah.
Don't start your own label, just quit. We've always said we're metal, we're punk, we're ska, we're all kinds of stuff. We just play music. And so if you don't focus too hard on one certain kind of trend, then it's easy to kind of survive that as they fade, as they come and go, if you will.
If the band keeps working as hard as we work and doing what we do,
we'll all be dead soon.
Yes.
Thanks, everybody!
Hey, hey, you're tuned into WALT.
You just met the band Less Than Jake and heard from the Chicago band Dick Wolf.
But that's all we've got for you today. Be sure to check us out next time.
And remember, cool cats, stay alternative.
Do you use any special equipment in particular?
Is this during the show or after?
Sorry.
Describe your ideal lady.
The only thing around this club are two strip joints.
Yeah.
And factories and train wrecks.
And a toothless hooker.
It's all about the booty. What up? Uzi wants to work with Justin Bieber, write a song with him.
We don't need any more Biebers out there.
Haley! DJ Haley Hazy!
Hazy Hay.
Haley Hazy.
Just slap. Slap the bass.
Action.
I don't do it.
If you're gonna be in this air band, you need to learn the f***ing song.
And the magic touch.
I just have one last question for you. That'll be it. Do farts have lumps in them?
Mine don't.
I just my pants. Interview's over.